Can I ask you what, if you have any kind of golden rule for, you have suffered, for survival in your life when you've been near the brink or near breakdown? You've managed to survive without nervous breakdown, alcoholism, pills, or suicide, some of the four of the ingredients that often go into a great career.
I think that is common sense and a sense of humor, quite a bit of humor you must have, and then to be able to laugh at yourself and not take things absolutely so serious, mm-hmm. and also be able to forget, to throw them over your shoulder and just go on, yeah. press on, forget it.
You like to do that?
Well, I read in an interview, I'll tell you later whose interview it was, okay. I was asked the question, what is happiness? And I answered, bad memory and good health. And then I met Claudette Colbert and I said, did you read what I said? I've stolen it from you. So she said, that's all right, I've stolen it from Albert Schweitzer. But you see, that helps very much to have a bad memory, because if you live with all that bitterness and, oh, he did this to me and I, and it shows in your face, mm-hmm. and you should just forget it. And then, of course, good health comes in very handy.
Could you tell us some of the major things you've forgotten?
Oh.
I am sorry.
He's trying to be clever.
I am sorry, yes, and not exactly succeeding either. Depression and suicide are supposed to be Swedish national traits, aren't they? We always hear they have the highest rate and so on. Do you have any reason, since depression can be chemical, has anyone ever checked the water there? I wonder seriously why Sweden should have that reputation.
Yes, it's hard to tell. They blame it on the long winters, the darkness, the mm-hmm. cold weather. Maybe also the impossibility of communicate. They are much shyer. I mean, here in America, you say, hi, how are you? And how are you doing? And good for you. We are closed up. They have great difficulty in bringing out anything. And there's something a little, maybe it's a small country. And they try to pretend that they are very clever and they have solved most of the problems.
Forgive me, Ms. Bergman, for interrupting, but never have I more fervently wished for a longer format. I can hardly wait until tomorrow night. You will have to at home, but we will resume taping, and you will see the rest of the program tomorrow night with the wonderful Ingrid Bergman.
Well.
Good night. Thank you, and good evening. I decided to dispense with the usual entrance to the show because I hate to waste a second. Last night, as you I hope you know, I was having a conversation with one of the great ladies of the theater, one of the great talents of the theater, and one of the great ladies of the world, Miss Ingrid Bergman. We were talking about the intense emotion in the film Autumn Sonata, the new Bergman film, and how much, you were saying how much Liv Ullmann manages to get into a scene, and how much, and we were talking about how much you were able to work in a way that perhaps you never have before and suspected that's why you wanted to work with Bergman. And a thought occurred to me, is it somehow degrading to the actor in films that total amateurs also can come off well in movies? You know, a director like Louis Malle will take totally inexperienced people and you really can't tell that they aren't actors.
No, degrading it isn't. But it is fun to see how these amateurs have such marvelous faces. They are chosen because of their faces and because mm-hmm. what they are in real life. They can't change. Very few of them anyway can change and play anything else. They play themselves. They play what they're picked up to play. I had plenty of that in all my Italian movies. Mm-hmm. My former husband hated actors. He loved to pick out the amateurs that had these marvelous faces, you see, and I was surrounded by people that had no idea what they're doing. But
we've all had that feeling.
it becomes difficult for the professional actor to work with amateurs because mm-hmm. they really don't know anything about where to look, and if you give them a sign on the floor, they'll walk further, and they don't know how to repeat an emotion and all that. But they turned out very well, of course.
Yes.
Our only hope is that they can never do it again, you see.
It is sort of a one-shot affair in most cases, because then they seem to become conscious of what they did and it all falls apart. Can you think of anything? It's supposed to be crucifying to see yourself on the screen for the first time for anybody. And yet I've had actors say, no, I thought I looked fine from the beginning. I was wonderful. Can you think of anything you saw when you first saw yourself on film that you didn't like? Your neck, your head, your nose,
yes,
your eyes?
I should say so. I had a tremendous shock, and I was only 18 years old.
I was
shocked then. You see yourself in a mirror, and you see the other way around. You never see exactly what you look like.
Mm-hmm.
So when you see the face, the way you look at my face, that's not what I see in the mirror.
Right.
And it is such a shock to see that suddenly your teeth are going up in this direction, your nose is going a little bit this way, one eye is bigger than the other. And you start to laugh, and it isn't at all the way you think you look when you laugh in the mirror.
Yes.
The whole thing is a great shock.
Are you considered to have a good side?
Yes, I was, but...
Are you considered to have a bad side, is
yes,
what I mean.
Yes, good side of it. No, but that was Hollywood, and I had never heard of it in Sweden.
Uh-huh.
And then when I came to Hollywood, I was asked by the very first cameraman, which was my best side, and I didn't know. We never bothered about those things in Sweden. So they did tests and discovered that, I can't remember anymore, I think this was the best side and that was the bad side.
I'm looking
Which
at the
means,
bad side now.
Yes, that means that in close-ups, they always try to put you in such a way that when the close-up come in, it was from there. Well, there is a difference in our faces. Each side is different.
Yeah, they're not symmetrical.
Yes, so naturally, one is maybe more photogenic than the other.
I assure you that I would never mistake your right side for Ernest Borgnine. Or
Well, there were actors who drove this to lunacy in Hollywood. They wouldn't come in a door without coming from the right side, and they had to rebuild the sets to suit the face of that person. And Charles Boyer was very much aware of his good side, and it was very lucky, as I made several films with him, that we matched each other. I mean, his good side was my bad side, so we could play together, you see what I mean? I don't know how actors do it, if they both find that their left side is the best, because then they have to stand behind each other.
They have to do movies in which one of them follows the other constantly,
yes.
I guess, so they can shoot it in profile.
Anyway, when I came to Italy and I mentioned that, en passant to my Italian director, that if he possibly could shoot my close-ups from that side, it would be maybe a little better. And he just laughed, and he said, what are we talking about? Am I going to think about your good or bad side? I'm thinking about my movies, and I'm thinking about how you act. I couldn't care less from what side you're shot. So that took kind of care of that. Never mentioned it again.
I'm glad to hear that.